Thank you very much. I think, Pat, I too am thrilled to see so many people here. Thank you very much for coming. I have the arduous task, I guess, of trying to answer this question, and I guess to possibly to Pat's disappointment, I have no confidence at all in that task. But what I want to do is to tell you some things that I think are really important about pain, the role of the brain, and some exciting future opportunities that are presenting themselves. And it's a very auspicious day today. Today is International Star Wars Day. Did anyone know that? I realised this dropping my kids at school, and on the radio came the full music to Star Wars, which is probably the greatest music theme ever written. And it's today because May the 4th be with you. I didn't realise that, but it's a great day to put on International Star Wars Day. I'm very new to the University of South Australia. I started there earlier this year. I started here earlier this year. And one thing I've been very impressed with is the global strategy to improve health. I've just been in the bathroom upstairs, and when you walk into the bathroom, there's a sign that says, "Please use all facilities to avoid congestion." And listen, I'm completely uncongested, so I thought I might be late because I was using all facilities, but let me start off by not talking about pain, but talking about vision. This is the way that we understand vision. So for those of you who have just walked in off the street, this is a brain, and it sits inside your skull, obviously. We think that light hits your retina, travels to the back of the brain, where millions of brain cells flip the image back around the other way so that you can see what's hitting your retina. That's wrong. It's not nearly that simple. This is vision. So there's no stigma attached to vision, like there might be to pain. There's no emotional context of vision itself, although it may evoke emotions. So vision, and please forgive me if there are vision researchers here, vision is relatively simple. No one's walked out yet, which is... Let me show you something really interesting. Some of you may have seen this before. When you look at square A and square B, hopefully you will all see quite clearly that square A is darker than square B. Raise your hand with courage if you do not see that. Well done. We've got one particularly clever person. Watch this. This ball doesn't change colour, so it's clearly the same colour as A. It still doesn't change colour. It's clearly the same colour as B. A and B are exactly the same. But we don't see it like that. If we were just seeing what's hitting the retina, we would see the facts, but it would make no sense. Hopefully some of you saw that, and hopefully what you saw was two grey panels, and you would have noticed that one grey panel is a different shade to the other grey panel. I show this to patients who are disabled by chronic pain as a way of proving to them that in a split second, and outside of your awareness and outside of your control, your brain creates a visual experience for you. And it does it really quickly. Sometimes it's wrong. That's what you probably saw. But if you cut out some key information, you'll realize that in that split second, outside of your awareness, outside of your control, you don't conjure an image that shows different colors of gray. Your brain is doing that. What is your brain actually doing? Well, the vision researchers, the people who do illusions like this, tell me that in that split second, and outside of your awareness and control, your brain sees that there's a really bright bit here, and there's a really dark bit here, and there's a shadow there, and there's a horizon there. There must be a light source there, which means the top panel must be in relative shade to the bottom panel. So a very complex reasoning goes on. Lots of different cues are being used by vision. And all this happens, boom. Out comes, I'll show you something that's not quite true. I'll show you something that's biologically advantageous to you. So what's really happening with vision? So here are those two particles of the original illusion. A and B hit your retina with identical frequency or wavelength. It goes to the back of your brain, and all of those brain cells then interact with a whole range of other brain cells based on complex mechanisms. An incredible interaction between brain cells. And ultimately, you have a conscious experience that you can see is related to what's hitting your retina, clearly related. But it's been tweaked. It's been modified by something that you don't know about. You have no conscious control over. I am as clever as South Australians are, I haven't met anyone who could consciously run through that process. Okay, light, dark, light source, I'll make that darker. We don't consciously do that. That happens outside of our awareness, and I think that's a critical point to remember when you're dealing, or when we're dealing with people who are disabled by pain for which there is no obvious MRI finding or X-ray finding or CT finding or blood test. It's tempting, if we're outdated in our understanding of pain, to conclude that they must be mistaken or lying about it. And hopefully in half an hour you'll agree with me that that's an erroneous conclusion. I'm going to take on the very daunting task of describing pain biology from a noxious stimulus, so a dangerous thing that happens, to the experience by talking to you about an episode in my life. About 8 years ago, I was camping south of Sydney in the Wallandilly National Park, and I got up very early and I put on my sarong. Very, very groovy. I got it from Bali and I rolled it over, and I'll reenact what happened on this morning. Did you see that? I'll show it to you again, right? I rolled up my sarong, very groovy. Now, biologically, I'll tell you what happened. Something touched the outside of my left leg in the skin. It activated things called Paxinian corpuscles and other receptors that sit on the end of really fat, not really that fat, but really wide, myelinated, fast-conducting nerve fibres. And that message travels very quickly up my leg, straight into my spinal cord, straight up my spinal cord, across to the other side, and it gets all the way up to the very top of my brain in primary sensory cortex on the other side. And it effectively says, you've just been touched on the outside of your left leg in the skin. Meanwhile, whatever that thing was is enough to stimulate danger receptors. Now, we call danger receptors nociceptors. Noxious danger receptor. And they're very thin, slow conducting, piddly little fibres. And they run up the leg and they get to the leg and they get into the spinal cord and they say to the spinal cord, danger on the outside of your left leg in the skin, mate. And they release all these neurotransmitters, and those neurotransmitters excite another nociceptor sitting inside the spinal cord, which runs up to your brain and says to your thalamus at the bottom of the brain, thalamus, spinal cord, listen, there's danger in the outside of your left leg in the skin, mate. And the thalamus quickly looks around. What else is important? Nothing is more important than this information. I think I'll tell the brain. Brain, danger on the outside of your left leg in the skin. Well done. And the brain evaluates this. Okay, that's very good. Thanks for telling me, thalamus. Where am I? I'm in the bush. What am I doing? I'm walking. It's that stage of my gait cycle. It's that part of my leg. My brain, in its wisdom, concludes, no, this is not dangerous, actually. This is not a dangerous situation. We've been here a million times before. I grew up walking barefoot in the bush. I had so many scratches on my legs that my nickname was Scratchy at school. And my brain knew full well, this is not actually dangerous. kick off the twig and go about your business, which I did. So I got to the river, I took off my sarong, I had a swim, put on my sarong, and then started walking back towards where we were camping. And that's the last thing I remember. And 3 days later, I woke up in hospital. The first survivor of the eastern brown snake, grade three, whatever the bad, nasty bite is. And the way that the poison of the eastern brown snake works is fascinating, apparently. But one of the ways that it does it is by exciting nerves. So actually, I would have had a whole lot of danger messages coming to my brain. But my brain thought, no, I'm not going to create leg pain here. That's not biologically advantageous. 6 months later, I was walking in the bush again. I can never reenact this one very well. I feel embarrassed reenacting this. But importantly, I was in a conversation with a boring talker. You all know a boring talker, don't you? You know those people, it doesn't matter what they say, it's boring. Well, we will call this person Naomi. Because that is her name. And this is what happened. Yeah, right. 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 Yeah, whoa, whoa! And I am in agony. I have a white hot poker pain screaming up the outside of my leg. I'll tell you biologically what happened. Something touched the outside of my left leg in the skin. It activated Paxinian corpuscles, other receptors on the end of fast-conducting, myelinated, so myelin around the nerves, and that runs up my leg, straight up my leg, into my spinal cord, up my spinal cord, across to the other side, right up to here, and it says, just me touch on the outside of your left leg in the skin. Meanwhile, whatever it was dangerous enough to activate danger receptors, nociceptors. That message crawls up these small, thinly myelinated or unmyelinated nerve cells, nerves, gets into the spinal cord and effectively says to the spinal cord, danger on the outside of your left leg in the skin. Come on, Adelaide. That activates second order spinal nociceptors which run up into the brain and say to the thalamus, thalamus, yeah, danger in the outside of your left leg in the skin. The thalamus has to work out, is there anything else that's distracting me? By no means. I am looking for a way out. Brain, I've got a great bit of news for you. Danger on the outside of your left leg in the skin. So the brain now has to evaluate, okay, thank you, how dangerous is this really? In a split second, outside of my awareness and outside of my control, my brain picks up that I'm walking in the bush. I'm at that stage of my gait cycle. Previously, I almost died in this situation. And the way I make sense of my experience is that the brain made my leg hurt so much that I could do nothing else but protect my leg. And in that way, that's what pain's doing, working to protect us. I fell off the side of the track and I'm holding my leg and the whole walking party has stopped and is looking after me. Perfect system. I don't know what Naomi was doing. She might have kept walking, I'm not sure. But hopefully you can see in those two scenarios. The first scenario, severe noxious input, a lot of danger, no pain. Second scenario, oh, I didn't tell you what happened. It was a scratch from a twig. And being a physiotherapist, and I'm sure there are some among you, we would have been trained to recognise that behaviour as symptom exaggeration behaviour. But I can guarantee you I was not exaggerating my symptoms. It really hurt. So as clinicians, I think we have a responsibility to stop asking the question, why is he pretending that hurt so much? I know a twig scratch can't hurt like that. Biologically, that's an erroneous question. That's the wrong question to ask. The right question to ask is, why is that hurting so much? And that's the thing that excites me as a scientist. How can that happen? And we sort of know how it can happen in a funny sort of roundabout sort of a way. So you probably can't see this picture, but this man here has three knees. The orthodox knees and another one halfway down his right shin from a fracture. This is from the height of the osteoporotic steroid abusing athletes. A danger message arrives at the brain in a split second, outside of your awareness, outside of your control. Your brain has to evaluate a whole lot of complex things. Really, related to the meaning, what does this really mean? In order to produce pain. And ultimately, the question that the brain has to answer is, how dangerous is this really? Based on everything I know. There's a whole lot of experiments that can show that this mix-up between what's truly happening at the tissues and what your brain might see as a need to protect you. There's a group of researchers in the States who have spent 30 years on one paradigm, which is using a very, very posh-looking sham head stimulator. And they get supposedly normal, healthy volunteers, and I do that because I ask the question, who volunteers for pain experiments? Is it really a healthy, normal cohort? And I would argue that it's not. If you were in Oxford 4 years ago, you would have come across a notice on a notice board. Subjects wanted for pain experiment. Who phones the number? When you do phone the number, one of the postdocs in our group might say, well, come down for 3 hours. We'll put a helmet on your head with lots of electrodes on it. Now, we do have to stab your scalp at each electrode in order to make it bleed a little bit. But it doesn't hurt that much. Then we will inject salty water into the muscles of your pelvic floor. Who still wants to volunteer? And then we have to warn you that there's a 50% chance that you will lose control of your bowel, but we have a lot of blue sheets in case we need them. Who volunteers? And yet we have this body of knowledge based on people who have volunteered for pain experiment. One of these paradigms is to get supposedly normal, healthy volunteers to put their head inside a stimulator. Now, the big trick is that this stimulator does nothing whatsoever. However, it is attached to an intensity knob. And these healthy volunteers have to report what they are experiencing, and they will experience head pain according to the intensity knob level. And you can replicate this with having a sound that goes wah, wah, wah. It's all about the brain's implicit perception of threat to body tissue. In these experiments, head pain depends on the perceived danger to the head. So pain is the end point, and this happens very quickly outside of your awareness, outside of your control. This is an experiment that we did some time ago with a fellow in the Netherlands called Arno Arndt, where we had a very cold piece of metal, minus 21 degrees. And when you put that on your skin, it's very cold, funnily enough. However, if we told you nothing else but just said, we want you to tell us about this stimulus and we get a lot of data out of you, we're only interested in one piece of data, and that is, how much does it hurt? And we just show on the probe one of two lights. One is a red light and one is a blue light. And we do a lot of trials with a lot of people. And at the end of it, we come out with a comparison between how much this minus 21 degree probe hurts with a blue light compared to how much it hurts with a red light. The only difference is the colour of the light. These are the pain data. So there are some people for whom this makes no difference whatsoever. There are some people who get exactly the same stimulus and rate it at 1 out of 10 when the light's blue and 8 out of 10 when the light's red. And we understand the physiology of this in the periphery. The messages are not that different from a very hot stimulus to a very cold stimulus. But if we think about the meaning of blue and red, which is hot and cold in our lives, we can see a very clear argument that very hot things are very dangerous. Very cold things are quite dangerous. If you can buy that. When you jump in a very cold bath of minus 21 degrees, you're not going to die straight away. Right? But if you jump in a fire at 100 degrees, that's a bad thing to do, and I'd highly recommend you don't do it. So how does the brain actually do this? Well, the brain is astounding at its capacity to represent everything else. When I got to Oxford University, the provost of my college said, welcome. Everyone who starts work here, we normally get you to partake in a study outside of your normal area of interest. And I said, okay. And we've looked at your CV and we'd like you to study Italian. And I went, ugh. And I got to my first Italian lesson. 25 of us there. Everyone else was studying a master's of Italian literature or Italian art or Italian politics. And I was a clinical neuroscientist with a full-time job and a family. And the fellow who took the class, whose name was Dante. Something's not right there. Dante said, can I just get an understanding of where you are linguistically? And I'm already nervous. And then he says, just raise your hand if you speak fewer than 5 languages. And I went, there were 2 of us out of 25 who spoke fewer than 5, and the other fellow spoke 4. And Dante said to me, 3? 2, you only speak 2 languages. 1 language. I nodded, and then Dante looked at me and said, what is it? And I thought, I can't even speak English very well. But what amazes me is that these people have, a fellow I worked with called, this is not his real name, it's an extended version of his name, Gian Domenico Alessandro Magnifico Fantastico Ionetti. He spoke 9 or 10 languages fluently. And what amazes me is that his brain has all the words I have 10 times. So he has this head that rests on his shoulder. It's about this big. No, clearly he doesn't. His brain is the same size. The way the brain does this is by representing stuff with networks of neurons, networks of brain cells. So I'm going to try and turn you all into a brain. I haven't done this before. I really hope it's not a flop. I think I'm still on probation. Let's pretend you're a brain. All right? And can everyone who was born between February the 1st and February the 20th raise your hand? Okay, let's say you guys are the network of brains. Let's make it all of February. Can February hold up your hand? We should make it 9 months after February. If you were born on November the 14th. Okay, so February, hold up your hand again, please, February. Right? You are the network of brain cells scattered around the thalamus, the cerebellum, the primary sensory cortex, the insular cortex, the motor cortex, parietal and occipital cortex. You guys, when you all work together, the organism experiences pain. Without that, we don't experience pain. Okay? Does that make sense? You've all got to work together. Now, let's say the thalamus, you're hearing the information from the spinal cord. So you're really important. And every time I say to you, danger in the outside of your left leg in the skin, you turn around and you're trying to convince the rest of the February babies, come on, let's do this. Let's get activated. And if you do get activated, the organism hurts. Is that okay? The organism experiences pain. Is that all right? Meanwhile, let's say that at the same time I'm scratching myself on a twig, I'm getting swooped by an F-111 fighter jet. This happens. So, meanwhile, the spinal cord's saying to you, danger in the outside of your left leg, but the auditory system is saying, there's an F-1 fighter pilot coming. So clearly you're not going to tell February babies, up you get. you're going to try and recruit something else. Does that make sense? Yeah? And let's say we've got a situation where you're all ready to work and the primary motor cortex, which was up there somewhere, you've got someone else asking you, no, go for the try line. That's a bad example here. The grand final, it's the last weekend in September. And you're 4 points down, go for gold. Ignore this other input. So you don't come to the party, so the network doesn't activate. Is that okay? We need the network to activate. If too much of the network activates, then we don't get the precise output. So can you put up your hand if you're a May baby? There's a lot of us, isn't there? I'm also a May baby. Put your hand up if it's your birthday on May the 4th. So let's say the May babies, we're responsible for activating the neurotag that produces the word isosceles. And we're not going to produce the word, saying the word isosceles, unless all the May babies are involved. Is that okay? And let's say, can all the May babies put your arms up and listen to this? Isosceles. Perfect. However, if you are like my son Henry, Lord Adorable Squeaky Pants, he's trying to say the word isosceles and he can't get it. And it's a little bit as though he hasn't worked out how to just recruit the May babies. So if all the May babies and the first 2 weeks of June, put your hand up. Isosceles. We're not precise. Can you see what I'm getting at? You can tell I haven't tried this before, but we need sufficient activation of the member brain cells for the tag to be activated, for the network to be activated. And we need to stop non-member brain cells from activating. Is that okay? And they're scattered all over the place. So let's say that this was the network of neurons. It's really made up of a whole bunch of them, like I said before, and this person cannot have pain unless you activate all of those brain cells. We need sufficient excitement of those brain cells to have neck pain, for example. But we also have to inhibit all the other ones. And these two mechanisms in the human brain underpin all of the representations. Precision on everything. It might be that a lot of those member brain cells are involved in, I'm trying to think of an Italian word, that's how bad I was at it, motor car and la macchina, which is the Italian version of motor car. Might have a lot of member brain cells involved, but the final network will be slightly different. So if we think about pain, we have to acknowledge that if pain is the output that is determined by activation of brain cells and it's a network distributed across the brain, we have to acknowledge, let's say the green one is a conceptualization of the brain's pain neurotag in a particular individual. And let's say it's back pain that neurotag would produce. There is also a neurotag or a representation. Tag is a word that I use that's short for signature, a neural signature. Let's say that you have the belief that your back is inherently vulnerable. It's not a very strong device. If you have that belief, it will be represented by a network of brain cells. And that network of brain cells shares neurons with back pain. So now this belief has the capacity to modulate the pain network. Let's say that you know that your dad, he was also a sheep shearer, and he ended up with a bag back and ended up in a wheelchair. You put two and two together and you realise, wow, that's going to be me. If that process occurs in your brain, and it's the only place it will occur, then it has the capacity to modulate the back pain neurotag. And we can now put into this complex reasoning mechanism anything relevant to the brain's evaluation of the danger to the back. So we have to, if we're going to embrace the complexity of the human brain to produce consciousness, I think we have to embrace the complexity of the human brain to consider information not from the body when it produces pain in the body. It would be daft not to do that. And you can put anything, sensory cues. I work at the Australian Institute of Sport as a consultant to their elite athletes who are underperforming because of chronic pain. And we had one cyclist, world junior champion cyclist, and we could turn her pain on and off by tilting her visual field as though she was going uphill or not. And we could modulate her pain at the right spot. It was the other sensory cues that activated the key brain cells, member brain cells, enough to turn on all the February babies so the leg hurt. It wasn't the thalamus driving that one. Social context. Sometimes your back doesn't hurt at all when you're at the physios. Sometimes your back hurts a lot more when you go to the insurance doctor. Now, there's two perspectives we can have. One is you pretend your back hurts more when you're at the doctor. There may be truth in that, I'm not sure. But we have to accept that your back might hurt more. It might actually be more painful in that social context. Anticipated consequences, and you can put anything you like in there. Some of the patients that I see, when they can grasp onto the fact that their pain is always worse after their mother-in-law phones up. It might be related to their mother-in-law. The other thing that's really important is that when the brain produces pain in response to its evaluation of danger, it will correct the spinal cord. And this is really exciting and really a beautiful system. A danger message arrives at the thalamus, the brain does all of this groovy stuff, and if the brain concludes the thalamus or the spinal cord is overestimating the true danger. For example, one is bitten by a snake and one's brain concludes this is not dangerous, it will conclude the spinal cord is just overdoing it. And a normal homeostatic process is that the brain will tell the spinal cord to be quiet. Descending inhibition. And many of you would have heard of descending inhibitory control. And one way of conceptualizing it is that the brain concludes the spinal cord is overestimating the true danger. That's good. This is a good thing. It's a great thing to capture. You capture this as soon as you take the box of Panadol out of the cupboard. You do. Your brain knows, I've been here before. What if the brain evaluates the situation differently and says, spinal cord, you're underestimating the true danger level? Let's say you scratch yourself on a twig and your brain evaluates the true danger in its mind, or its perceived evaluation of threat, and it concludes, spinal cord, it is so much more dangerous than you think it is. Then it will excite the spinal cord, and we call this descending facilitation. These are incredibly potent mechanisms. This is bad. This sends more messages to the spinal cord to excite it, and is a self-fulfilling prophecy, if that makes sense. So we know all this about pain, but these pain being a conscious output of the brain. We can apply exactly the same way of thinking to movement. You move according to your brain's perception of the demand and your capacity to meet it. And you have evidence of that when you go to pick up a bag that you've packed full of books and you rip it off the ground not realizing that someone else has emptied the books out of it. Your motor command is on your evaluation of what's required. So I hope that makes sense. We could apply the same thing to fatigue. You can take a world-beating elite athlete cyclist to their absolute tolerance. And you say, you go on the trainer as fast and as hard as you can go until you cannot physically go any further. And then you rig up a little device that as they press the button to quit, you show the finish line. And guarantee they'll go faster to make the finish line. And there are different names given to this sort of principle. But fatigue is an experience produced by your brain to protect your body. Thirst is the same. This is a little bit more speculative, but I think it fits completely with the paradigm. Anxiety relates to your brain's evaluation of your capacity to cope with the demands. Not your true capacity, necessarily. So what we're trying to do, I guess, clinically, is to match up perceived and exact truths, if you like, which is obviously difficult to do. What happens when pain persists? Well, if we look at what would be the ideal world, you injure yourself, it becomes inflamed, it scars, it remodels, and your pain goes away, and then in a while, your tissues are as healed as they will be. That's perfect, and if that always happened, we wouldn't be spending $35 billion a year on chronic pain in Australia. And it doesn't always happen, obviously. So here's another participation. All right. If you were born in the months of January, February, March, or April, right, I hope you all know when you were born, you have to, soon you'll see these yellow dots land on the spinal cord there. I hope this works. And I just want you to count them out loud. All right, as a group, count them out. And if you were born in May, June, July, or August, you do nothing until you see an arrow head up here. All right, it will look slightly different to this. When you see that, I want you to say, danger! If you were born in the remaining months of the year, when you hear two danger messages, shout out, ouch! And then you start again. You reset, okay, everyone? You reset. When you send a danger message, the counters start again. When you go, ouch, the counters start again. Have you got it? I hope this works. Oh, sorry. Good. Good practice. Good practice. Here's the real one. Okay. I think they might have got mixed up. In case I can't go back to this, we might have more practice. What we would see in this scenario, this is the messages coming in from the tissues to the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, and the messages coming down from the brain. The sum total of that determines when a danger message will be fired. If that keeps firing, it becomes sensitized. So we call it a sensitized spinal nociceptor. We'll do the same thing now, okay? Counters, are you ready? Danger, messenger, nerve people, spinal nociceptor, yep. Ouch team. Okay, let's try, see if it works.
One, two, three.
Yes, well done. So in a normal nociceptor, we need 10 of those neurotransmitters to get one danger message. In this scenario, no ouch. In a sensitized nociceptor, we now only need 5. The change has happened in the spinal cord, not at the tissues. Let's say pain persists, or let's say the noxious input persists. Oh, here it is, from before. I thought it might. So.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Okay, that's normal. Now we're going to fire straight on. Oh, forget this. Sorry. Nice.
1, 2, 3.
Okay, now scientists call this a really sensitized spinal nociceptor. Here we go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Nice. Don't give up the 1, 2s. We've obviously got the flu. Hopefully you can see what's happening in the spinal cord. And we understand the molecular biology of this. The longer you have pain, the better your spinal cord gets at producing danger messages. So now you only have to bend over here to set off a danger message to your brain, even though there's no real danger in the tissue. But your brain doesn't know that. Oh dear, sorry about my animation, forget this. Nice, I love your commitment. Very good. What happens in the brain? So we know that you can fire up the nociceptive system, but you can have a completely sensitized spinal nociceptor and not be in pain. For example, if you lose a limb, you will get a sensitized spinal nociceptor, but you don't necessarily get phantom limb pain. So sensitized nociceptive system is not enough for chronic pain, but it's a really common lead into it, I guess. Exactly the same thing will happen in the brain. The neural mechanisms are thought to be very similar, if not the same. The more you run the pain neurotag, the better it gets at running. You learn it. This is a bad situation. Hopefully you can see that this is a bad situation. The implications of this are twofold. So we get, remember we had member cells, so all of the February babies are the pain neurotag, and they just get more and more excited. So now, sorry, what's your name?
Marisha.
Marisha, have I got it? Yeah. Marisha only has to look at you and you go, ouch! Right, now if we take that into the brain of someone with a 25-year history of back pain, they only have to think about bending over and their back hurts. And we have brain imaging data that show quite clearly that they're not lying. EMG data that show quite clearly they see someone else pick up a box, their own back muscles tighten up and their back hurts. And we understand this, they're not pretending, they're not feeble individuals, they don't have different personalities before this started to everyone else. They're really common misconceptions. The other thing that happens, so aside from just getting more sensitive, the brain loses its capacity to stop the other cells from firing. So we get reduced inhibition. If you remember that we have to have to produce this really nice, defined, clear back pain, we only want February babies activated. The longer you have pain, then the March babies start getting activated. And your pain is spreading down your legs. We're losing precision. Pain is spreading up your back. It's coming up in different spots. It jumps around. Your legs start doing things that you're not controlling. You start to feel like your arm's really swollen when it's not. These are all very real perceptual experiences that we relate to a loss of inhibition in the brain. So we have too much excitement and a loss of inhibition. So it's more sensitive and it's less precise. For those of you who are not physiotherapists, I'll let you in on a trade secret. Physiotherapists love the pelvic tilt. And I'll show you my pelvic tilt. It's very good. See that? Very precise. I can do that because I have a very clear map of my pelvis and back, and I can differentiate them. Physiotherapists love it when someone comes into the clinic with a 5-year history of low back pain, because they know they won't be able to do the pelvic tilt. They've lost the map in the brain. Their brain's map of the pelvis and the back is no longer precise enough for them to do that movement. So as a physio, you get frustrated at having to do the subjective evaluation, the interview. You end up saying, no, yeah, okay, whatever, show me your pelvic tilt. And the patient says, what? Show me your pelvic tilt. The patient is amazed and they do this. Show me that again. Pelvic tilt. And then what the clinician does is the clinician tells the patient, put your hands on the front and the back of your pelvis. All of that information we know pours into the brain and works on inhibitory mechanisms. Activates all the capacity of the brain to be precise, to wake up inhibition, if that doesn't sound too much like an oxymoron. Sometimes it still doesn't work, and we hope it doesn't work, so that we can eventually say, just come over here, give me your hands, put one there, can you feel that? We love the pelvic tilt. You could go up to Arundel Street Mall, just have a look at the people who are just standing back. It's the wall watching other people walk past. Or watch yourself and you'll see the physiotherapists. They walk like this. They do. It's a true story. You know, if you have a new baby, there's probably some new parents here, and you tend to rock at the bus stop. You don't realise it. You're still rocking. All right. The parents who are also physiotherapists. Is it any wonder that 5 years of low back pain, your brain just cannot differentiate these things? Intuitively, clinicians from across disciplines will recruit mechanisms that reignite inhibition. which have symptomatic benefits. And research that I've been involved with and others now shows this in randomised controlled trials, that these things reduce pain. There's good evidence that this disinhibition, this lack of precision, is contributing to the problem. What we're now uncovering is that it's these sort of issues are contributing to physiological dysfunction in the tissues. And that's a bit more intimidating, but also far more exciting from a scientific perspective, because it tells us that we may have opportunities at the brain to change the body. New opportunities. What do we have to do about it? Well, I guess the very first thing we have to do, I think, is change the way we think about chronic pain. Pain here, at this level of intensity, because of changes in the nervous system, actually, and the immune system and the endocrine system, but not because of the tissues, feels exactly the same as that pain. It is as intense, it is as unpleasant and horrible and disabling and frightening. It is as unbearable and unbearable to live with. And I think we have to remember that. There's nothing not disauthentic, is that the word? There's nothing that's not authentic about that pain. And I think that's a critical acknowledgement that we have to make. We know from 15 years of research now, understanding this, as a patient, understanding this helps. Reduces pain, reduces disability, increases participation in rehabilitation, all these sorts of things. What else can we do about it? And I guess the principle, aside from understanding, is that we need to address these two things. And our group has been targeting the brain as a way to address these things. Ultimately, training the brain. In one sense, we identify everything that's setting off the February babies, whether it be visual cues, the meaning, understanding, all of those different things. It might be tissue input. But we've spent a lot of time focusing on there, and we do really good things there. I don't want to give the message that we're not interested in that. We really are. But we need to look beyond that. Absolutely. And there are mechanisms by which we can recruit the precision mechanisms. And that, I guess, really is the cutting edge of this work. There are several teams around the world who are trying their hardest to optimise training inhibition. And really interestingly, there are groups who are trying to train inhibition for autism, for Parkinson's, for schizophrenia. These problems seem to go across fields, and I think that there's a real opportunity to learn from each other. Here's some resources, so I've technically got 1 minute to go. This is our website where we try and translate scientific articles into normal language that are related to these things. These are a couple of books that I've written. These are the people involved in the Body in Mind research group. Sorry, it disappeared so quickly. If you want to get involved in experiments or studies, email Tracy. I haven't asked Tracy about this yet, so if you get a really abusive email back, tell them that Alan Evans told her to do it. Thank you very much for having me. Thanks a lot for coming tonight. I'm sure we've got time for at least one or two questions, but thanks.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks, Lorimer.